So, the recording is starting.
Okay, let me talk a little again about the Second World War from the standpoint of what it did to the generation involved and how it shaped society's attitude toward them, you might say. Now, there were only 130 million Americans at this point, a little over that. And there were 12 million men under arms during this war. In other words, about a tenth of the whole population, you would have to imagine over 30 million today to get something comparable. And more than 7 million of them served overseas. There were more than 400,000 men who died, 291,000 of them in combat. Others died of disease. A lot of people died in accidents and so on. And the official figure for wounded is only 671,000. So that's a ratio of killed to combat wounded of only a little more than 2 to 1. That ratio of wounded to killed has increased a lot, first in Vietnam and then in the more recent wars in the Middle East, because emergency medical services have been improving so much. People are medevaced in helicopters in the battlefield and so on. But still, there were plenty of people who came out of it disabled. Now, this was, of course, the biggest, most brutal war in human history. Fortunately, nothing like it has taken place since. A couple of you know this. In 2009, I was interviewed by Steve Bannon, who at that point was a very obscure right-wing publicist and documentary filmmaker. And he was already a big fan of Strauss and Howe and looking at it from his particular point of view. And actually, he was very charming during our interview, and we had a good time talking about all this. He was very eager to try to get me to say that the fourth turning, which then just seemed to be beginning, was going to result in another huge war. And that was clearly what he thought. But I was not willing to say that, and I didn't say that, and I would say that that prediction is looking worse.
David, could you repeat again the date that you had this interview?
2009. And the documentary, which is nothing to write home about, that came out of it is called Generation Zero, and you can see it and me on YouTube. But I wasn't on it for very long.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Anyway, it was particularly brutal, of course, for civilians, although not American civilians, who suffered in a lot of ways. Of course, millions of civilians were murdered by the Nazis. When the war was over, an even higher number of civilians, or certainly a comparable number of Germans, were expelled from various places in Eastern Europe and driven into Germany in one of the most massive pieces of ethnic cleansing ever. And of course, it all culminated in August of 1945 with the two atomic bombs, which clearly put us into a new era. Now, what did the victory mean? Well, it meant the survival of our democracy, and it meant the survival of democracy in Western Europe. It even meant, thanks to the occupation policies of the victors, and especially the US, that democracy took over in West Germany and in Japan. But because the Soviet Union had been such a critical ally, supplying most of the manpower and the tanks and the artillery that actually beat the German army, and because they too had reached German territory, it also meant the survival and the expansion of communism, which became, of course, our major preoccupation for the next 45 years or so, with all sorts of consequences that we'll be looking at later. This meant the victory of the Allies, that many nations would not be brutally ruled by the Germans and the Japanese, although some of them would be brutally ruled by Soviet communism. That was not all. Throughout the advanced Western world, what became the NATO area, there was a swing somewhat to the left or the center left, and there was a commitment to avoid all the problems of the interwar period, particularly unemployment, that had led to fascism and war. And we put together a new political order, a new economic order, all of which has lasted until very recently. And now, of course, for the first time, we have a president who doesn't believe in any of that, and who has done some things, at least, to undo it. The other thing...
David, could you repeat that last two sentences?
We set up a new economic and political order with a lot of new institutions, which have lasted until now, but now, for the first time, we have a president who doesn't really believe in that order and who has done a good deal to undo it, although it's still there, at least officially, at this time. Now, we now have, 70 years later, a new perspective on the effects of the Second World War and actually the whole period of the two world wars in the advanced countries. In Western Europe and the United States. All of them had to mobilize tremendous resources to fight those wars, and then after the Second World War, to recover. In addition, they all felt that they had incurred a debt to the men who had fought the war and their families. And for those two reasons, the period from about 1914 to, I think it's about the middle of the 1970s, saw a great decrease in inequality in all those societies. Again, that was partly because the rich weren't so rich. They had to be taxed at rates going up to 90%, marginal rates of 90%. Nobody paid 90% of all their income. But there was a figure, and it was only, I think, $200,000 a year in the US, where basically anything you earned over that went to the government. Situation in Britain was similar, on the continent, not quite so much. But still, and also a lot of money was wiped out in various ways by inflation, by the Depression, etc. Now that period, as Piketty has shown in his books, was the only period in modern history, that is, for which we have good economic statistics and income statistics, that inequality actually declined significantly. We live under capitalism, and this is the big contribution of Piketty's book. Increasing inequality is the natural result of capitalism. If you don't intervene actively to go in a different direction, that's what's going to happen. Beginning in the 70s and 80s, we unleashed capitalism again. We cut back taxes, and as a result, inequality has been increasing ever since. But in addition, and this is what comes out in this movie and others, there was this real commitment to providing for the needs of ordinary people and a lot of concrete steps in the United States that worked very much to the economic benefit of the GI generation. And in a lot of ways, those domestic benefits and these new institutions, attitudes, federal programs were what the GI generation won by fighting the war. Strauss and Howe pointed out that even before the war, our society, and particularly the New Deal, was quite focused on the well-being of young people, which then meant the GI generation. I think I mentioned this last week, a lot of the New Deal programs helped them very directly. The Civilian Conservation Corps, the Public Works Administration, the Works Progress Administration that provided a lot of jobs. And there was even something called the National Youth Administration, which provided a lot of benefits to people in college and in other ways. But the parents of America were very solicitous about their kids. I mentioned last week that I was trying to confirm the statement of the black soldier whose reminiscences I read from, that General Patton had said that Negroes could not be tankers, that they weren't up to operating the equipment. I could not find that But what I did find doing a newspaper search was an enormous amount of commentary on the famous Patton slapping incident, which plays a central role in the movie, in which he had slapped a soldier who he accused of malingering in a hospital that got broken down from battle fatigue. It took a while for that to break, but when it broke, it was a national sensation. It did seem to put an end to his career as a leading general for a while, although he eventually got it back. But I actually saw editorials saying, this is what we're fighting for. We are a country where a common soldier can't be treated this way by a general. And isn't that wonderful? So there was a lot of concern for the soldiers in many ways. Now these men were coming back. There was a great deal of fear that with the war over, there was going to be another depression, another round of huge unemployment. And we were doing a lot of things to try to prevent that from happening and to prepare the veterans for a productive life. And that led to the passage during the war of the GI Bill. There were a lot of aspects of the GI Bill. One of them aimed at housing, and it actually provided interest-free loans for veterans to make a down payment. And the other one is the one that we are looking at in detail this week, the educational benefits. We looked at it at the micro level in the movie, a few words about the macro level. About half of all veterans used the GI Bill in one way or another. 2.2 million used it for college. 5.6 million used it for other forms of vocational training. It was harder for Black veterans to use it for college, not because the program itself discriminated against them in any way, but simply because there were fewer colleges that they could go to. Nonetheless, it did increase the number of Black college graduates, as well as white ones, a lot. And in fact, women, of course, didn't get any direct benefit from the GI Bill, although we saw some of the indirect benefits that they got. And between 1940 and 1950, college enrollment doubled. There was another impact of that on the silent generation, which was kind of interesting. Judy Bell and I both know a member of the silent generation who was born, I think, in 1928 and entered college in 1946 and in the Ivy League. And he told me that he was surrounded by veterans in the classroom and so intimidated that he didn't open his mouth the whole 4 years. And I think that experience is quite characteristic. Another veteran who went to college at that time, presumably on the GI Bill, was, of course, George H.W. Bush, who had a very typical GI life in a number of ways. There were other impacts to the war that were going to have a transformative effect in the next 20 years. It gave a huge boost to the civil rights movement. There were a lot of Black veterans. They came home and refused to be treated the way they had been treated in the South. Some of them brought their weapons with them. There were some terrible lynchings and other violent episodes against veterans, though. And Harry Truman, the first of the two Lost Generation presidents, along with Eisenhower, a veteran himself of the First World War, was very affected by that and felt that something had to be done for everyone. And thus in 1948, as he was running for re-election, he was the first president to come out with a real civil rights program. And he also ordered the desegregation of the armed forces, although that was mostly on paper, really, until the Korean War. But it did get it going. The NAACP was becoming a very important Washington lobbying organization. They were already pushing ahead with their legal strategy, trying to integrate education, starting out actually, and this has been going on for a while, with lawsuits to get Black students into professional schools, which were quite successful. they persuaded the courts at a relatively early age, for instance, some of the southern states, they said, okay, we understand we have Negroes who want to go to law school, so we'll send them out of state to law school. But the argument in the court, which is a sensible one, was that they had to go to law school in their own state where they intended to practice, and the court fought that. Actually, reading the reminiscences of Walter White, who was then the head of the NAACP, I saw a lot of interesting stories about the late 40s. These cases were coming up and were obviously causing some controversy on campuses in the South and in the border states. And a lot of the white students, many of them veterans, were siding with the black students. Far more, actually, it seemed to me, than what happened 20 years later in situations like in Mississippi and Alabama. So that was moving ahead. Truman's civil rights program had massive consequences in the Democratic Party in 1948. There was a Dixiecrat revolt led by Strom Thurmond, who we all remember. And Thurmond carried, I think, 4 southern states in the Deep South, but Truman managed to win. From the civil rights standpoint, this was another interesting period in another way, this post-war period. Until Roosevelt, the Negro vote, as it was called, such as it was pretty heavily Republican. That went all the way back to Lincoln, and it hadn't changed. Roosevelt changed that to a significant extent. Since 1964, as we all know, the black vote has been predominantly Democratic. The period in between, I would say, from the 30s through the early 60s, was the only time in American history where the bulk of the black or Negro vote was really in play. It could go either way. And I don't think it's a coincidence that that was also the period in which we made the greatest progress, particularly through Congress, on civil rights. There was another aspect to all this, which I remember very well from my childhood. A lot of people from white minorities, such as Irish or Italians or Jews, particularly if they were educated, very much identified with the civil rights struggle and contributed to it in many ways because they had suffered various forms of discrimination as well. This is a point that I feel very strongly about personally. A lot of people today talk as if every white person before, let's say, the late 60s was a bigot, or at least that was the default position. Hillary Clinton, for example, my exact contemporary, when asked about her own father, has commented, well, he had the attitudes of his time and place. And this always drives me nuts because I knew quite a lot of white people in those days, and the ones I knew were not racists at all. In fact, they were extremely committed to civil rights and thought it was very important. And that's part of the reason that we did get somewhere in that day. Last but not least, we'll get to that later, okay. There were other huge psychological consequences to the experience of the war. And I think we can look back at it now and say something that you wouldn't have heard at the time, that there was almost a national epidemic of PTSD, of post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, the GIs had their own way of coping with this, or their own ways of coping with this. Anybody want to talk about that? Yes, I just saw Chaz make a gesture. Would you like to speak, Chaz? I can't hear you, Chaz. Can everybody hear Chaz? No. Chaz, you're mute, I think.
Yeah, you're muted, Chaz.
Sorry, Chaz, you're not coming through.
Hold up with his mic. So you said, yeah.
Well, the gesture he made was of raising a glass to his lips, and that certainly was a major coping mechanism. Another huge coping mechanism, also chemical, was nicotine. Nicotine, I never used nicotine at all, really. But somebody, I finally read a few decades ago that nicotine is a very powerful anti-panic medication. And that explained a lot to me about who used it.
Hello.
Yes. Go ahead, Chad. Chad?
As I said, self-medicating through spirits.
Yes, self-medicating through spirits. Right. So that was another way. Another way for the men was simply to be workaholics. And the economic system promoted that as well, since 2 weeks vacation was pretty standard in those days until you've worked a long time. And the women, meanwhile, got very busy having and taking care of kids. Actually, a good friend of mine, another historian, wrote a book about GI veterans and PTSD. And one of the interesting things he found out was that a lot of them didn't really show symptoms until after they retired. Up until then, they'd been busy enough, but then they fell apart. And I remember very well that a lot of GI wives or widows were very affected in the 90s when Saving Private Ryan came out with its highly realistic depictions of battle. And many women were quoted to the effect, oh my God, you know, he never talked about it, and now I understand why. So there was a lot of that. The GI generation could keep their emotions in check. One of the things that makes generational dynamics go is that the children act out the things that the parents couldn't act out. And I am convinced that that is one of the reasons for the emotional explosion that we're going to see when we get to looking at the boomers in the 60s. Again, we talked about this last time. Yes.
David, we lost that last couple of sentences. Can you repeat it, please?
I've forgotten what I was saying.
You were talking about the children.
Oh, yes, yes. I think that...
Emotional explosion.
Yes, I think the emotional explosion of the boomers in the 60s was to some extent acting out for their parents, actually. And behaving in ways that their parents put it. And that is the way generational dynamics often work.
David?
Yes.
David, just a suggestion. I think you need to keep the volume of your voice up in general. It tails off, we lose you.
Yes, all right.
So you need
to I'll try to do that, and I'm moving a little closer. Okay. Thanks. All right.
David,
yes.
Just a question. I'm just curious about the emotions. The one generation is kind of keeps their emotions bottled up, and the next one is more overtly emotional. Is that something that alternates then generations? That one is a little bit more closed and.
Yes, I think it probably does.
The next one is open.
Although actually,
which is unique to this particular pair.
No, it isn't. Going to the archetypes, the argument of Bill Strauss and Neil Howe was that, let's see, nomads and heroes, that is Lost Generation and GIs, tend to be relatively restrained emotionally. Artists and prophets, that is Silence and Boomers, tend to be the opposite. Yes, Chaz, that's resonating with Chaz.
It's resonating with some stories that my mother told of her family. Her nomad, lost generation grandmother was very, well, actually, no. Her grandmother was born in 1885, but was very colorful. Let's put it that way. Her mother, who was born in 1909, however, was extremely restrained, and my mother never really could understand why she was so restrained.
And your mother was a silent
45.
Or a boomer? 45, okay, yeah. Susan?
Two things come to mind, and one is that, I guess probably the most important one is that we're talking about an era when Freudian psychology was beginning to become part of the culture. It was just the very beginnings. And so I think that the attention being paid to one's own emotional state has done nothing but increased, you know, as the years have gone by. And also men, I mean, the men were not, they it wasn't acceptable for men to talk about their feelings or their, you know, to cry or you know, emote about the things that they had experienced. They were supposed to be tough. We've come a long way in terms of understanding the impact of war and so on people's lives and their psyches, and witness what's going on today. So that's just I don't think that we're looking at cyclical rotating, one generation is this way and the other generation is that way. I think we've just been on this sort of growth path in terms of understanding ourselves better and being more accepting.
I think that is true, and we'll talk about this down the road, because I do think that was certainly one of the great things about the awakening. Your reference to Freud is kind of interesting, because yes, Freud got people thinking about the unconscious, but from what I know about Freud and his early disciples, it was very constricting in that their premise was that every man and every woman had the same conflicts, and therefore a Freudian analyst had diagnosed you before you ever opened your mouth and was just trying to fit you into the proper box. You were disagreeing with that. But I think there was a good deal of that going on.
This is a field that I trained in many, many years back, but I don't think that's a very simplistic view of what actually took place.
Yeah, that strikes me as a bit of the pop culture backlash that you see in like the late 50s, early 60s period to Freudian thinking.
Well, I have known a therapist who was a silent and who decided that to understand his patients, he had to find out a lot of details about their lives, their parents' lives, et cetera, et cetera. And he said, I think he had been trained as an Orthodox Freudian, and he said that was regarded as very revolutionary when he started doing this, maybe in the 60s.
I don't see how, you talk about Freud, you also have to talk about Carl Jung. And he was very discriminating about the male and the female, the animus and the anima. There was nothing, they were two forces in the unconscious, but they were not the same.
Go ahead.
All I'm trying to say is that at that time, in the 30s and 40s, Freud was, his work was beginning to gain attention.
Oh, and yes.
That's all I'm saying. And I'm not saying that he became mainstream or anything, but it was certainly in that period. Even it probably wasn't until really the 60s when you had a Freudian approach to, or psychoanalysis was really almost a mainstream sort of treatment approach. I'm not trying to talk about his view of male versus female. I'm just saying that the attention being paid to one's behavior and the emotions giving rise to it was really coming into the stream of consciousness of society at that point.
Yes.
I would say that's true, the last thing you said, but by the 60s, the humanism was coming in, existentialism, there were a lot of different approaches, and therapy was becoming much more mainstream, where before that it was much more A, for sick people, and B, for rich people, because,
yes, right,
there wasn't insurance coverage, et cetera. So it was a really different.
I was saying, that's exactly what I was saying.
Yeah, I guess I was just saying it wasn't just Freudian in the
No, sixth. No, no, not at yeah. all. I mean, you had Est.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, right. And Lennis.
That was the rage.
On the other hand, institutionalization of mentally ill was at an all-time high. And according to some estimates I've read, by about 1960, the time that One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest was written, there were close to 1 million people in mental institutions in the United States, which is quite a striking
thing.
Okay. And again, it was a very conformist period in which everybody, almost everybody, tended to do what everybody else did. And TV, which began to take over entertainment, I'd say by around 1950, with only three networks, certainly encouraged all those trends too. Now, I regret to say my preparation skipped a step, which I have in the outline. One way to get an insight into the emotional character of any age is to listen to a little of the music that they were listening to. So I planned to pull up a little late 40s music, but I didn't get around to it, I see now, and I'm very frustrated. Thus, we will do that in a subsequent meeting, and perhaps we'll be able to use it for contrast. But I have listened to the top 10 for 1947 when I was born, and I always feel that it was a miracle that I or any of my contemporaries were ever conceived, given the kind of music that our parents were listening to at that time. It really hardly moved the emotional meter at all. But we will get to that.
I beg to differ.
All right, who are you talking about? Go ahead. Oh, I've lost. Wait a second. I can't hear you.
I don't honestly, I'm just saying, no, I don't agree with you, but I don't want to get into it.
All right. Let me give you an assignment, which is to come up with a YouTube clip for next time that will make the point that you're trying to make. Have you got something for us, Jess?
I have the Billboard Top Hits 1948 that I can share.
Oh, please. Let's hear a little.
If you enable sharing.
Share screen, you mean?
Yeah, you have to go to security and enable participants to share.
Oh, okay, just a second. Enable share screen is already there. Yeah, it's already there.
Yeah, but you have to make sure participants can.
Yes, I checked it. Try it.
Alrighty. I'm not sure. Computer.
Remember to check those boxes down at the bottom.
Oh, I am.
The faucet, she is dripping, and the fence, she's fallen down. My pocket needs some money so I can go in the town. My brother isn't working and my sister doesn't care. The car, she needs a motor so I can go anywhere.
Mañana, mañana, mañana is soon enough for me.
My mother's always working, she's working very hard. But every time she looks for me, I'm sleeping in the yard. My mother thinks I'm lazy, and maybe
okay, I agree with David on this one.
I gotta work mañana, but I gotta sleep tonight.
Mañana, mañana.
I can skip to another.
It's good enough for me.
Oh, once I had some money, but I gave it to my
friend. Let's hear a little of something else.
Yes.
That actually was relatively lively for 1948. There we go. Oh, yeah.
Every day I reminisce, dreaming of your tender kiss, always thinking how I miss my happiness.
one.
Have gone by since we shared our dream, but I'll hold you again. There'll be no blue memories there, where the skies are gray or blue.
I think that's enough. Okay.
Made your point.
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
And that first one was so racist. It's just unbelievable.
Well, at the time, it's also kind of the trend of the popularity of South America in general that you have in the time.
Racist.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. For some reason, we've lost video from Judy and Susan. I don't know.
No, I did that.
Oh, you did that. Okay. Right.
Accidentally. Yeah, right.
Okay. There you go.
Right. There we go.
Yes. Okay. To get the spirit of the age and the feelings of the GI generation in particular, I do have a couple of other clips from movies that I'm sure most of you have seen. The first is from Best Years of Our Lives, in fact. Has anybody not seen The Best Years of Our Lives? Oh, wow. Okay, well, I'm sorry you have to miss it right now, but the whole thing is right on YouTube, and generations aside, it's an amazing movie about three returning veterans. Now, one of them has come out of the Army as a sergeant, where he saw a lot of combat in the Pacific that he never talks about, and he's played by Frederick March, and he is a banker. I just got unstable connection again. Can you hear me? Good. Okay.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, good. Frederick March is a banker. He has just had a fight with his boss, who was played by Ray Collins, an actor which all the boomers, at least here, will recognize right away. But the bank is having a dinner in his honor, in which he and Ray Collins are going to speak. And Frederick March has fortified himself for the dinner by having a lot of drinks even before he got there. And then he comes time for him to make a speech, and he talks very effectively, I think, about how he feels to be back in the business world and how he is trying to carry some of the wartime spirit further. So here we go.
Stand today where it has always stood, the citadel of individual initiative, the land of unlimited opportunity for all. It is peculiarly appropriate that we meet here tonight to honor one who has valiantly fought for that freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, we greet our friend, our co-worker, our hero, Al Stevenson. Come on your feet, Al. On your feet.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here. In fact, I'm very happy to be anywhere. In fact, I'm very happy. Perhaps it'd be a good idea if you just put that bottle right down here in front of me, hmm? Save yourself quite a number of trips.
Good old Al.
Well, I'm glad to see you've all pulled through so well. As Mr. Milton so perfectly expressed it, our country stands today where it stands today, wherever that is. And I'm sure you'd all agree with me if I said that now is the time for all of us to stop all this nonsense, face facts, get down to brass tacks, forget about the war, and go fishing. But I'm not going to say it. I'm just going to sum the whole thing up in one word. My wife doesn't think I'd better sum it up in that one word. I want to tell you all that the reason for my success as a sergeant is due primarily to my previous training in the Corn Belt Loan and Trust Company. The knowledge I acquired in the good old bank, I applied to my problems in the infantry. For instance, one day in Okinawa, a major comes up to me and he says, Stevenson, you see that hill? I said, yes, sir, I see it. All right, he said. You and your platoon will attack said hill and take it. So I said to the major, but that operation involves considerable risk. We haven't sufficient collateral. I'm aware of that, said the major, but the fact remains that there is the hill and you are the guys who are going to take it. So I said to him, I'm sorry, major. No collateral, no hill. So we didn't take the hill, and we lost the war. I think that little story has considerable significance, but I've forgotten what it is. And now, in conclusion, I'd like to tell you a humorous anecdote. I know several humorous anecdotes, but I can't think of any way to clean them up. So I'll only say this much. I love the Corn Belt Loan and Trust Company. There are some who say that the old bank is suffering from hardening of the arteries and of the heart. I refuse to listen to such radical talk. I say that our bank is alive, it's generous, it's human. And we're going to have such a line of customers seeking and getting small loans that people will think we're gambling with the depositors' money. And we will be. We'll be gambling on the future of this country. I thank you.
Any comments?
Yeah, I liked how his wife was being supportive there.
Yes.
With her reactions and also by monitoring his alcohol consumption.
Yes, although she knows she can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
That's Myrna Loy, who's also wonderful.
Myrna Loy is pretty famous for being the wife of the drunkard too. So she's
That's true.
Major experience. We actually watched it yesterday. We watched both the movies yesterday to kind of compare and contrast them. And I think one of the things that I thought was lovely in the film was the way she, as a wife, welcomed him back, even though he obviously had changed quite a bit. And she was determined to do her duty to support him and help him get back to his new normal. I found that a lovely part of that particular film. And that their daughter was equally dedicated to bringing the soldiers back to a place where they could feel good about themselves.
Yes. And her name is also Peggy, and she is another silent, in fact.
Yeah. There were two Peggy's in the silent last night. That was interesting, too.
Yeah, right.
Can I ask, was it, again, to me, it's obvious that the Frederick March character is pretty deeply wounded from that experience. From that clip, and yet my experience with the people of that generation is that a lot of them, as you've said previously, just put that stuff away and didn't talk about it. And so my question is, was it obvious to their contemporaries that they were deeply wounded by their experience?
No, I don't think it was. And in fact, that speech is the only time that he talks at all specifically about his war experience at all, in terms of something happening. And obviously, he's doing that partly for humor or for effect. So no, I think for many people, it was not obvious. And one of my best friends His father was a medic in the South Pacific and never spoke to him about it at all. And they had a pretty good relationship too. Janie, yeah. You're muted. Oh, sorry, you're muted. Hang on.
Yeah. Okay. No, I'm there. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, I think that one of the strong characteristics of the GI generation is, in fact, that they were treated as heroes when they came home, as opposed to those who fought in Vietnam, even those who came back from the Korean War. And certainly it was my experience where I grew up, that's all the adults talked about was the heroism of World War II and what they had all done. And my own children's families, we're all multiracial, multicultural from all over the world. And what I have found interesting in that same generational loop, those who experienced the war from the Asian side of it don't talk about it. And for those who were part of the occupation, the Japanese occupation, and huge, just heart-wrenching experiences, it's very hard to get them to talk about what really was it like to, you know, starve in the jungles and so on and so forth. Whereas the American GIs came home, they had saved the world and they had made all these sacrifices. And so it was a celebratory experience, which I think was obviously critical to their psyche and how they responded. Also, in the post-war, particularly by the early 1950s, when everybody came home, there was in small towns, if you were in retail or any kind of selling anything, people were so eager to buy that there was a lot of money to be made in providing household goods and clothes and TVs and all the rest of it, because there was such a pent up need to do all of that. So when you talk about a time of a high, I mean, it was an incredible high. And then the other thing I wanted to share is that, you know, we talked about the consumption of liquor and tobacco for the GI generation. Remember that a good part of the GI generation, they were teenagers during the Prohibition. And as teenagers, they drank a lot and cheated a lot. And so by the 1950s, it was de rigueur when the cocktail hour started at 5 and you were drunk by 9 or 10 o'clock at night. Everybody was. And you look at the movies of that era, and you know, there was always the sideboard, you always had the decanters of whatever it was that you were gonna drink, and everybody had a drink. And I remember as a child, you know, getting up in the morning after these sloshing parties on Saturday night, how the cigarettes and the liquor and the whole bit was just was pretty appalling. But they all did it. That was the deal. So
I am just amazed now at how sensitive I and everybody else really is to the merest whiff of cigarette smoke. Since for the first 15 years of my life, it must have been absolutely constant in the background, everywhere except in school. My father did quit, actually, when I was about 9, although my brother, my older brother smoked for a long time. So, I mean, it was just everywhere.
Well, that's what, you know, it's interesting in the tobacco industry when they're the whole vaping deal and sort of my professional, just the anger, incredible anger of the older people who have seen the incredible decline of nicotine and tobacco and the incredible abuse that went on, and then to have the tobacco industry and the vaping industry come back in and be determined to quickly addict the kids again. You talk about an industry that is out there simply to make money, but it is the parents of this generation who are you know, into this vaping stuff are so opposed to the tobacco stuff and are so angry, and it'll be interesting to see what happens to that. But anyway.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other comments on Best Years of Our Lives from the people who have seen it, which is most of you?
Well, David, of course, I've never watched the whole movie, so it's all out of context for me. But what about the clip did you think was important?
Well, actually, I it's true that you see what has happened not long before this is that Al gave a loan to a farmer, a would-be farmer who wants to buy a piece of land. And Lieutenant Tragg, his boss, was very upset with him for that because there wasn't any collateral. But he went ahead and did it. So this is his way of saying, and he did it because the guy was a veteran. And he even said that. And this is what he's saying, you know, I'm putting my trust in the young people of this country, you know, whether they meet your standards or not. It is a theme of that movie, too, that for the most part, the older generation just doesn't get it at all, doesn't know what we went through, isn't doing much to make life easier for us now, et cetera. That comes up a number of times. But the other thing that always strikes me watching the introduction and then his speech, it's a preview of the transition from Eisenhower to JFK, really, 13 years later. And from the lost generation to the GI generation in leadership. So that is what filled me about it. Okay,
Can I just say real quick, I found it interesting saying that they were considered to be heroes because this film doesn't necessarily portray them as believing that. Frederick March's son actually questions him on the bombing, and he's brought him some trinkets, a sword and a scarf, and his son's like, you know, these things are really important to those people. And the way he says it lets you know that he's saying, why did you bring this away from their country and bring this to me as a gift? And his mother says, just thank your father and take these lovely things and go, and she's trying to support him. And that's one of the things all three of the soldiers are dealing with. When they come back, they're not the men they were before they left. One of them is physically completely ripped apart, and the other two are emotionally and mentally ripped apart. And it's all burning underneath the surface, and they're having to find ways to let it kind of explode out of them and try to figure out what they deserve. I really think that's what the film is about. What do they deserve when they get back that they're not getting right off the bat? And I think all three of them end up making what they need happen for themselves. But it's a tough haul for them to get through that emotion and a lot of guilt. I saw a lot of guilt in all three of those characters about what happened that they couldn't stop in their three respective storylines.
Yes, I think there's a lot of survivor guilt. And in the same way, yeah. I think everybody who knew Mr. Roberts would feel that as well.
And I think that transitions into the apartment for Peggy because her husband is having that same guilt. Yes, what is my responsibility? What am I supposed to do versus whether I'm allowed to go in search of my dream or do I have to make the money and take care of this baby and all those kind of things that.
We have one more. We have plenty of time. There's one other movie I want to talk about a little again, which I'm sure almost everybody has seen, which I have a very brief clip. It's A Wonderful Life. Okay. Could anybody summarize George Bailey's story as a GI story, a story of someone in the GI generation?
He's always putting his personal ambitions aside to do what's right for his community.
Yes, right.
Over and over again in his life. But then in the end, he realizes that was his true destiny and his community came back to him and to sort of complete the circle.
And save him.
Yes. And that leads me right to where I was going to go, which is the clip from the very end of the movie, which was a favorite, actually, of Bill Strauss. I'm not talking about it with him.
Hear them coming now. George, it's a miracle. It's a miracle.
What's happening?
Who's gonna come, Daddy?
Who, Daddy?
Come in, Uncle Billy. Everybody in here.
George! Yeah, brother, come. George! Is everything isn't it wonderful? So many friends. Mary did it, George. Mary did it. She told some people you were in trouble with it. They scattered all over town collecting money. Didn't ask any questions. Just said, George in trouble. Have come here.
What is this? Another run on the bank? Here, George. Merry Christmas.
There we are. The Lime Farms on the right. The Lime Farms on the right.
Come in, George. Merry Christmas.
I wouldn't have a roof over my head if it wasn't for you, George.
Just a minute. Quiet, everybody. Quiet.
Now get this. It's from London.
Oh.
Mr. Gower cabled you need cash. Stop. My office instructed to advance you up to $25,000. Stop. Oh. Hee-haw and Merry Christmas, Sam Wainwright.
So, wait a minute. Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So, what is the lesson of the last scene? Steve pointed out George has been doing the right thing for other people all his life. And now, he gets his reward, his well-earned reward. And as we will see in the next couple of weeks, particularly 2 weeks down the road, actually, a lot of GIs certainly did seem to feel that way, and the rest of society.
Speak up a little bit, David.
Okay, a lot of the GIs did seem to feel that they had earned their reward, and society seemed to go along with that in many ways. As we shall see. Okay, on to an apartment for Peggy. So, what generations have we got?
Peggy is a silent.
Peggy certainly is a silent. There. Yes.
You have the GI, William Holden's character, and then I think the elder professors were not lost, but the previous generation to that.
Well, the only one who definitely looks like a missionary to me is Henry Edmund
Gwynn.
I was thinking he and then his contemporaries there were probably of the same.
I don't think they are quite his contemporaries, though. They're still active. They're not retired.
Okay.
He had retired, so he was definitely in a different a way ahead of them.
Yeah, okay. I kind of feel like they were like intergenerational friends.
Yeah, held together by music. Okay. Now,
And they looked up to him, it seemed.
Yes, I think that's right. Yeah, Jazz? Okay.
That was agreeing with James.
Right. Now, this movie has a lot of resonance for me for a lot of reasons. Henry, he says, I was watching carefully this time. He says, 8 years ago, they retired me. So that was probably when he was 65. So he's now 73. Edmund Gwenn, I think, was 71 when he made the movie. He was fresh from his great triumph just a year earlier as Kris Kringle in Miracle on 34th Street, for which he won the Best Supporting Actor Oscar, something I had forgotten. And George Seton, who was the writer and director of An Apartment for Peggy, was also the writer and director of Miracle on 34th Street, which also features an even more famous Silent Generation actress than Jean Crane, namely Natalie Wood, as you may remember. But anyway, did Peggy remind, does anybody else besides me feel that they have known Peggy or somebody like Peggy? Just curious. Yeah.
Could I just say that Peggy made me want to open a vein?
Oh. And why was that?
Oh, she made me crazy. So opinionated and never stop talking. And that's, it was hard. It was hard to take in a way. Jeannie Crane is not that attractive to me, to look at her and listen to her all that time. So my opinion.
Did anybody else feel that way?
I felt like she dialed it. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I was going to say, I thought she was pretty unbelievable. And I'm thinking as she was 19 years old, and it's like, really, they're going to listen to a 19-year-old? I can see how the script was written, you know, to convey certain ideas, and it's very generational. But you know, the wisdom of a 19-year-old today in this age, we'd go, ah, you're too young, you don't know anything. I thought she was a little over the top in the way she delivered it. So.
Okay, Jocelyn and then Susan.
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think I bought her as a character, but I felt she just was one or two notches too animated. And I don't know if it was the performance or the direction, but it just was a little, yeah, I was with Judy to some extent where I'm like, just back off just a little bit. But I bought her as her, you know, what was motivating her and her enthusiasm for her family and, you know, solving the problems that she was faced with. So I appreciated that. I just felt like, her personality was a little, like she was taking something.
Well, it's interesting that Judy seems to feel like we were supposed to really love her uncritically, which I have never felt at all. I think she's supposed to be humorous and certainly somewhat over the top, although charming in her own way. Now, there's only one person here who ever met my mother, although that person knew her a lot. Now, my mother was a GI, but she certainly had some of the same qualities as Peggy. More to the point, I have a lifelong family friend who, let's see, Peggy is 17 in 1947. So my friend who was still alive was 4 years older than she, but also a silent, and quit college in about 1945 or six to marry a returning GI. And they went through college and medical school on the GI Bill. She too, although her personality is somewhat different, she had the same, she tried to run the lives of the people around her for a long time. So that resonated for me too. But the again, these young silent wives, who a lot of GIs married, and who did give up college or quit college or whatever, that was a very real phenomenon. There were also some very famous cases like that, of which the most famous is undoubtedly John and Jackie Kennedy. So that's a real sociological phenomenon you're watching there, leaving her particular personality aside. Yes, Susan.
I'm not that knowledgeable about Jean Crane as and her acting history. I'm just looking on my laptop at the other films that she was in and not much. Well, State Fair, but I felt that both she and William Holden were sort of early, I suppose, kind of screwball type. You know, there was this element of screwball comedy in the film, and it wasn't entirely obviously screwball, but she was a character, and he was too, really, in seeing him in a somewhat comedic role really was quite interesting to me. And the whole film has a certain there's certainly comedy in the film and some very funny lines. So I didn't object to her at all. I just felt that she was who she was. She was playing the role of this kind of almost zany, but not completely wife. And it was just the way she was told, you know, the script was handed to her and that was the way it was to be played.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Chaz.
As a character type, I kind of equate her with the trope of the quote-unquote manic pixie dream girl, as it's now called. It's a much more acceptable kind of personality and probably attractive to younger folks of, like, younger Gen X and younger in terms of that. And I feel like Peggy would have fit in terms of personality more with that crowd. But at the same time, I kind of feel like it's the same kind of story beat you would get with that kind of trope. She's there to be the vitality to reinvigorate someone who's basically a brooding, close to suicide person. In the typical Manic Pixie Dream Girl story, it's usually she's trying to cheer up her moody boyfriend. But I actually found it was kind of refreshing in that, oh, she's here to cheer up her moody grandfather figure. And you kind of get a chance to see her more as a person than you would in those typical cheer up your boyfriend kind of stories.
Okay. Yes, Janie.
Yeah. One of the things, and I'm sure it was the way the thing was written, where the young woman who lost her first baby, as though... you know, you got to get over it. You know, you can always have another kid. And there was sort of culturally that time of women, you know, being able to just cheerfully a day or two later, you know, comfort the older man. And it was the husband who felt guilty about all of it. And somehow, I mean, that really rubbed me the wrong way. I thought, oh man, the lack of understanding of what it means to lose a child. Very different today, but I thought that was very much of the time. And children, you know, and you think of how many children were lost, how many babies were lost, how many women died in childbirth, and it was just an accepted thing. You have another baby. But I thought that was, I don't know, I guess that was generational. That was the way it was. And the man felt guilty. The woman would get over it. So.
Michael, I think, had his hand up, and then Susan.
So I want to go back to something that Chaz said, because one of the first thoughts that I had when looking at this movie was, you know, were there people who really acted like Peggy Taylor? And David, you said you know someone who is a Peggy. I mean, So going back to what Chaz says, yeah, I see the manic pixie dream girl, but I think that's a brilliant comment and a great insight, but I don't associate that personality type with you know, this period. So were the, I mean, is this a type that you remember from, you know, that you remember from that era, David?
Well, I'm not quite that old, as you know, Michael, but I mentioned my own mother, who was a GI, but who had, I think my cousin Tamara would confirm this, the same total lack of inhibition that Peggy had, in that she would say whatever was on her mind, whenever it was. And the other woman I'm thinking about was similar to Peggy in that, I mean, she's extremely intelligent. Actually, she's been in many ways one of my best friends. But she really traded on being cute, just the way Peggy did, which also reminds me of Shirley Temple. And I even have a Shirley Temple clip, but there's another way you could get to see it. And it would take more time now than it would be worth, I think. So no, I don't think that would strike anybody at the time as somebody from another planet. No, I don't. And she's kind of a Bobby Soxer. She has a lot of youthful enthusiasm.
Thank you.
And at the same time, she has the same goals of a lot of other women, which is the next thing I want to talk about. But Janie, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, one of the things in the Strauss-Howe theory is that not every person in a generation will actually have the characteristics, the broad characteristics that a generational mood displays. And I think what's more interesting with this particular movie is the script itself and the broader themes and, you know, what do you learn from this movie thing. And I think that it becomes dangerous if you try to fit everybody that you know of that generation to fit the personality, because it wasn't meant to be that way. So that I think the script of this movie and what the meaning of it fits, but I think enough of us sort of think Peggy was a little over the top and not terribly believable, but it was written that way, I think.
So, okay, Susan?
Somebody else want to say something?
One thing that might be interesting is to compare it with the short story it was based on, which was written by a lost woman.
It would be, but I've never seen it. Yeah.
I just wanted to come back to the point about the response to her losing her baby and sort of the how that was treated. I mean, I think we have to kind of remember that this film is a Hollywood film, and Hollywood was not into exploring issues like that. At that time, and you know, the war was just barely over, I think. So you know, it's meant to be entertaining, but in fact, I thought that the whole scene with the women taking the course from the professor was really very, very well done, and just kind of gave the film some depth or some I don't know what's the word, but anyway, just it makes the film more memorable because of that that whole scene.
That's her arc. Her arc is from as the young person in the beginning of the movie trying to overcompensate and be more than she really is. Yeah. And then as she goes through the film and she loses her child, and she talks about she is acting this role as she's lost her child. She is mourning the child, but she is covering it up because she feels like that's what she's supposed to do. And then in the classes, all the men say, God, who knew women were so smart? And the film was written by a woman, and I went and checked too, because I was like, it doesn't feel like a film written by a man, and yet this woman is so over the top in the beginning, and that's because she's trying to be what she thinks she's supposed to be. It's not that she really is that person. She really is playing a character. She is a caricature in the beginning because that's what she's learned she's supposed to be. And I think she learns as she goes through and life starts to hit her from all sides that she can be more than that and really sincerely be that. And I think we don't get to see where that goes, but.
Okay, I just want to throw in a couple of quick things from my own experience. My mother had three kids. I don't know exactly how many, but I know she had more than six pregnancies, although she never talked about it practically at all, that about the miscarriages. And I definitely have the feeling that we boomer kids, we were items of mass production. And yeah, sometimes one comes off the line and it's a failure, so you just wait for the next one. And that was the way it was. Now, that is an interesting point. Okay, other people are waiting. So Judy, you had your hand up. Yeah.
Well, I wanna say that I'm sorry I brought
up
Peggy to begin with, because I was very impressed with the subject that this Hollywood film brought up, the subject of philosophy and philosophy in everyday life, teaching, and the difference between teaching and indoctrination. And I thought it was a very touching film. I didn't like Peggy, but I liked the movie. So
may I say, though, that I don't want you to apologize, and I want to hear from anybody who has a particular negative reaction to any character or anything in the film, because those reactions are extremely revealing, and they can be very revealing generationally.
David, I would just say that I watch a lot of sci-fi, for better or worse, and so the suspension of disbelief on some of these characters was pretty easy for me.
Yeah.
And I didn't think the movie was about Peggy, nor did I think it was about her husband. I thought it was about Henry.
And to a large extent it is,
And perhaps, you know, for any number of reasons, probably Freudian, you know, it starts off on a pretty heavy subject. He's contemplating suicide.
Yes.
And, you know, he's doing this somewhat matter-of-factly, but I don't think anybody would approach such a thing matter-of-factly. So as he's explaining it to his younger peers, the other professors, he makes a pretty good case. you know that basically, you know, my wife's gone, I'm retired, they've put me out to pasture. What have I got to look forward to? Just, you know, getting older, getting sicker, and, you know, basically declining, and doing so in a somewhat miserable fashion. And I also understood that the movie was going to come, I mean, as soon as Peggy sat down on the bench, you know, you could tell where this was going. You know, she was going to, as you were saying, Chaz, you know, she was there as an over-the-top character to save him. And while I think, you know, William Holden's character, his saving was also important, what was really important was Henry's role in saving him. You know, his re-engagement in life, not just, you know, not just to, you know, accept a dog and a cat in his house, but, you know, and lights going off and things like that, you know, but to accept that he had a responsibility to, you know, to Peggy, to her husband. And at the end, I felt that he also, you know, he looks up at the portrait of his wife and he has a responsibility to her. And, you know, so I kind of looked at the movie. I knew it was a post-war movie. I knew it was, and there were some really interesting aspects of that, you know, where William Holden's character, as you've all said already, you know, the responsibilities he felt after the war, you know, the way that men in that era, and I would say to this era, are repressed and believe they have these responsibilities to others rather than to themselves. And they see things in monetary terms. I just felt that the movie was almost an homage of an older generation to the younger generation, kind of saying, I'm sorry I wasn't there for you, I'll be there for you. And so I think that's what brought Henry back, is his sense of, you know, seeing others with responsibilities maybe he hadn't had, and he came back to that realization. That was kind of how
I think Henry, too, although I admit that this is me identifying with him, in addition to that he's been put out to pasture and his wife is dead, his world is gone. And he does not feel at home in this new world. And that is something I feel a lot
now as well in a lot of ways. Although I'm still trying to hang in there and do something.
Okay, we've got three here. But I do want to say, I mean, I think we had to go a little late here, just like Henry, because we're obviously nowhere near done. The scene, the class for the women, in addition to everything else, is one of the most unbelievably prophetic things I've ever seen in my life, because that is predicting the revolt of silent generation women that happened 20 or 30 years later, and predicting it perfectly. Yeah. Okay, Janie, Susan, okay. And James.
Sort of a broad question, because I know Bill always felt that one generation produces the culture or the sort of the main themes for the next generation. And I am no expert in any of these films at all. So I thank everybody for their information, because I'm learning a lot. But for this film and the other films that we've been watching, David, how do you respond to that? Because Bill would say you need to look at the, you know, who wrote it, who produced it, who was in it, and at some point it evens out towards the end of a generational or a cycle where you have the same generation beginning to produce for their own generation, but then it begins again so how does that jive, for example, with this movie?
Well, George Seaton, who directed it and who I thought wrote it, although apparently I'm gonna have to check on that, was a GI, although too old to have been in the war, probably. I think he was born in 1911. I about the culture though, I think you see the new culture that's being created by the GIs in this movie.
Yes.
And the way Peggy and Jason and their friends will do everything for each other and are together so much, that really resonated with me, with my parents. And again, my mother had no compunction about asking any neighbor or friend for anything she happened to need at that moment, and she would almost always get it. That's the best I can do about that. So I think you see the new culture being created, and Henry is very impressed by it, although it's very new to him, and by their ability to improvise. Okay, Susan, I think.
I just want to make one quick comment, because we're sort of circling around it, but the focus on Henry, definitely. Raises the issue of aging, and I think that was a probably fairly unique element in a Hollywood film at this point in time, and I was very struck by that.
Yeah, it is unusual, and actually, what's happened to Henry is happening on the national scene too, because FDR is dead, and by the time that movie was made, his whole cabinet was gone. Truman had replaced them all. And the era of the missionary influence was over. A moment that I know many younger people are desperately waiting for with respect to the boomers, but it doesn't ever seem to quite happen yet. But we'll talk about that later. James, I think you were waiting. Yeah.
Yeah, just a couple of comments. The scene where there were a bunch of babies and
yes,
bassinets, that was such a boomer.
Oh, yes.
kind of scene. The housing shortage was something that my parents certainly experienced. My mother and father lived in my grandmother's basement with two children for a couple of 3 years after the war. And keep in mind that Henry did try to commit suicide. He didn't have the right pills.
Yes, he did.
But he did try to do it. And of course, if the prophet archetype of Henry is the same as the boomers, then we've got the same issues now, which is the boomers' sort of inability to move off the scene. And yes. You feel sort of sorry for Henry that he's not ready on the one hand, but on the other hand, it seems to me what we're looking at today is we're overstaying our welcome, us poor boomers, and we're holding up a bunch of people behind us. I mean, yes. not to bring it too much to the present, but Anthony Fauci, who's a great American, is almost 80 years old.
I know.
Now, why in the world would somebody...
Thank God for
him. No, but there's plenty of good people 15 or 20 years younger than him that could do the same job. And why didn't he retire 10 years ago or 50 when at age 70?
Well, that is a huge difference. And I'm glad you brought that up because Henry evidently had no choice. And remember, until the 1970s, I think, that was normal. When you turned 65, that was it. And you couldn't do anything about it.
We need to go back to that.
Well, maybe. Okay. Now, I do want to talk some about Jason. And there are two things I want to look at or say. I'll just say the first one. His attitude about his family and his role is very typical of GIs. His job is to provide. His job is to make everybody comfortable. And that was a very common attitude among GI husbands and parents. But the second thing I want to talk about, partly because we're going to come back to it in a month or so, why does Jason want to be a teacher? Don't you remember when he made
To me, the answer is he sort of felt like it was bad education that led to the war.
Right.
To put it into a sentence.
That's right. And he wants ignorant. To make a better world by teaching everybody good values. And Peggy echoes that too about bringing up her kids, that she wants to teach them that everybody is the same and, you know, not the real superior to anybody else. By the way, I can't resist. The idea of having Peggy as your mother is about as nightmarish an idea as I could have. So in that sense, I do agree with a lot of people. But anyway, yes, Chaz, you were saying.
And as Peggy kind of elaborates on the vision that they share, it's they're not going to change the entire world. They'll just change. There'll be one or two who will contribute, right. And then they'll have a few more, and then it'll eventually overpopulate. It'll take a while, but it's got to start somewhere.
Yeah. And how does Henry's, I'm sorry, how does Jason's idea about the purpose of education differ from Henry's? I think Henry's is much...
Repeat the question, David.
How does Henry's idea of the purpose of education differ from Jason's?
Isn't it more about just appreciating the scholarship?
Yes,
and
but...
The education for education's sake in a greater society, but more just... because it's there and we must know it, we must appreciate it.
But he says asking why is very important. And education teaches you to ask why. It's education and curiosity, for curiosity's sake, I think. Yeah, Jane.
But when in the scene where he was teaching the class to all the women, I thought he realize that maybe that there was something beyond sort of the classical view of philosophy in education, where he was saying how where the women said, well, in a democracy where there is, you know, greater equality and we've got to push these values forward. And it was as though Henry hadn't thought about that, is that whether or not that was the place of education is certainly not for democracy. It was rather the educated people would rule everybody else because they were smarter. But the women pushed back on that. And I thought that was an interesting turning point for Henry.
Oh, well, Henry was speaking for Socrates there. It was not clear that that's what he thought. But I do think the women's commitment to democracy and belief in it was very, very striking.
Right.
Exactly.
Well, and it's the silent generation that really began the whole civil rights movement and it was sort of the boomers as college kids that broke it loose, but it was the silent the Peggys of the world who really began those movements and the real push, both culturally and politically. They were the ones that.
I have to disagree slightly on that. I don't think the silence began civil rights. They moved civil rights into the streets.
Yes,
and
that's right.
Into the lunch counters and the direct action. And in fact, the GI civil rights leaders, like Thurgood Marshall, were not happy with that at all initially and didn't even think it was a good idea. But it obviously did make a huge contribution.
Well, I think one thing that Henry said too after the class with the women was he was so used to saying his words and having his students not really listening so much as waiting for the clock to come to an end so they could stop listening to him. Right. And it wasn't until he lectured these young women and they talked back and they taught him something that he realized that education is a two-way street. It's not just a one-way street. And I really think that's a lot of what this film is about. I looked at a few of the other films made at the same time, The Philadelphia Story, Miracle on 34th Street. These are all films where there's an old man and a young woman and their interactions with each other and how important it is that they come to some kind of agreement that they can both operate in this time period. And so I see this film is doing that as well. And I think that what keeps him around at the end of the film is realizing that we need all the generations working together, that he can't just get out, that there's more to live for, even though he's lost his time period. This new time period still needs his education. And I think that that's an important element of this movie as well.
Okay, very interesting. I have one other question. Peggy's attitude toward Jason and her marriage, which I would describe as she's going to keep him up to the mark and make sure that he's on the right track. Does that kind of marriage still exist, do you think? You do, Janie. Okay.
I think it does, but I don't think it's every marriage, but I think there are definitely marriages that are like that.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not. Yeah, I don't think that that's necessarily generational in every sense of the word. I think it just depends on personalities and who marries whom. There will still be the drive, the women that drive it, or the men that drive it, or they sort of come to a mutual partnership. But I agree.
Well, I think there are plenty of women driving their marriages at this point, but I haven't run into that kind of situation where they're driving it via the man in a long time that I can think of. Kevin, yeah.
Just to make sure I understood, you're asking, is Peggy's character somehow genuine or authentic in the sense of a woman keeping her husband on track?
Is that what you're saying? No, it certainly was then. And again, the woman I've referred to was that way with her husband for his whole career. I mean, she was watching over him and making sure he did his homework and everything else. But I have not run into that in more recent generations very much. That's why I asked the question.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you think it was maybe an aspect
of there was a lot of that.
Okay.
I would say.
Because I was going to say that, you know, I've been living that for 35 years.
Oh, I see. Okay. All right, just on a personal note, which I can't resist, Henry is 73, as I said. I will be turning 73 in a few weeks. We're both retired academics, and therefore, in case you haven't already figured this out, you all are my spouse's class, the equivalent thereof for Henry. And certainly, like him, I very much appreciate your enthusiasm, and I'm looking forward to more week. So thanks. Anything else?
Thank you.
Not at all. Anything else anybody wants to throw in? Yes, Jane.
Wait. Okay. All right. Again, so I see. You know, it's revealing my lack of knowledge on all of these films. Again, going back to sort of the the films then that the children, the boomer children born in the late 40s and 50s, which is me, I'm same age as David. And I was just looking up Fantasia, was put out in 1940, Sleeping Beauty, 1937, Wizard of Oz, 1939. Those were major movies for the children who were born just right after World War II. That was what was available. I mean, there was other stuff, but those were the really beautiful movies that were put out, and we all knew and saw many times, and now we, you know, show them to our own children and our grandchildren. But it, do you see anything in that, David, because you know all the movie stuff, or not?
I'm not sure what you're asking.
Those movies were made by missionaries?
No, they were made by GIs and Lost, and they were made originally for Silence, but they kept showing them to us.
Okay. Right. Okay. That was my question. Okay, so they were made by Silence, because that was...
Now, what Bill and Neil said, though, and again, we're getting ahead of ourselves here, but it's a very interesting point. Disney didn't make any new cartoons for Gen X. And then with millennials, they started doing it again. And I think that's true. And it's very interesting. No? Not correct?
They did make stuff for Gen X. It just wasn't as frequent. It wasn't as timeless. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. What was produced for Gen X was a lot edgier.
Okay.
And very edgy.
Well, we will get to that in due course.
So David, I have to ask you, did you have any frustration with the character of Henry that rather than dealing with his situation that he wanted to end his life, was he?
I have a couple of other, as you know, major interests in my life. We're both musicians, but I seem to spend more time on it than he did. Plus, I still own my bike, which is keeping me sane at this point. Plus, I still am very happily married. I haven't lost that. And my sons are very much alive. So I'm not as desperate to see. But I was a little envious in a way. I guess I am. I don't know. I think, frankly, I am, that he was still living on campus. granted that I'm within shouting distance of Harvard and I can use the library there because I'm an alumnus, even though that's worthless right now because it's been closed for months. And by the way, I feel very strongly that if we had had this pandemic 40 or 50 years ago, the faculty would not have stood for that. They would not have stood for closing down the library, and they would have insisted on some way to allow them to continue to use it. And to me, that's a huge change in the life of the university.
But David, you can take the boy out of Harvard, but you can't take the Harvard out of the boy. Right.
Well, you've read my autobiography, James, so you know the whole story. Okay, thanks very much.
All right, thank you. Thank you, everybody. We're all sharing. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, and have a good night.
Not at all. Right. And we're going to have a great time next week. There'll be I'll give you a little specific assignment for 12 Angry Men. It's a very interesting assignment that I've had luck with in the past. Okay. Go on.